Ladies and gentlemen, boys and girls, please give a Dubai welcome to Mr. Linford Christie. Let me tell you, I have a real bugbear. I think the word legend is used too much in today's society. Let me tell you, boys and girls, ladies and gentlemen, this man is a legend. I promise you that. Right then, Linford.
Thank you.
Thank you. No, thank you for being here. Before I ask you, I'm going to pepper you with questions, and there is going to be an opportunity for you guys, you boys and girls, to ask questions of Linford as well. There's only one place to start. I'm going to embarrass you now. I want to play the video, Goosebumps. I watched this earlier today, this morning. Goosebumps watching this. Take a little look at this. This is Barcelona, 1992, Linford's greatest moment on the track, where all of his dreams came true. Ladies and gentlemen, Olympic champion. Right, come on then, Linford. You can tell us all, be truthful. How many times a day do you watch that video?
I wish it were true. I think this is the first time I've seen it in the last couple of years. I don't really watch it. And the reason why I don't is because I coach. And sometimes you can get caught up in, you know, your own hype. And then you become a little bit complacent. You don't want to coach the athletes the way they should do. So you want to forget all this and, you know, I've had my time and now it's for, the time is for the athletes I'm coaching. So yeah, we don't really watch it. We just focus on what they're doing now.
Talk to us about the emotions though, because I mean, I'm crying for you. I'm welling up watching that. When you do watch it, what immediately comes to mind?
I wish I was young enough to do it again. No, I mean, for me, I think it gets a little bit emotional because I suppose you don't see it all the time, but, you know, like I say, you just got to let it go and, you know, you wish that, you know, I was young enough to be able to do it again. And, you know, the training, I suppose, is the thing that you don't miss. You don't miss the training at all because it was pretty tough. You know, I trained sometimes 7 days a week, twice a day, 3 to 6 hours, you know, a day. And, you know, and for me, you miss the competition, but the work was just...
Yeah, we often talk, don't we? And again, young kids here listening, hanging off every word. I mean, you've climbed the mountain in athletics. sacrifice. We talk a lot in this world about, in order, and again, I say this of any industry, you've got to make sacrifices to get to the top. Talk about the sacrifices that you had to make in order to become an Olympic champion.
Well, there's a lot of sacrifice. I mean, for me, the biggest thing is you're an athlete 24/7, and everything that goes with health and everything else, you've got to, that's what you've got to stick to. So I didn't do the junk food. I didn't eat,
chocolate out.
No burgers, no, even still that. But I think, I can't dance because I spent all my time on the track. I didn't get the opportunity to go to the club anymore and everything. So, I got two left feet, and that's when the new dancers came in, I couldn't do it. You miss all like your family, get-togethers and everything else, because you have to give up a lot. And it's for a short while, and that's what I say. I say it's for a short while, you can give everything up. And, Muhammad Ali said, work hard now so you can live the rest of your life like a champion.
Love that, love that. There'll be a lot of kids thinking, wait a minute, I can't go to the disco, so let's not scare them off. Was it worth it? Honestly, Linford, all the hardships, all the sacrifices, all the early nights, all the passing McDonald's and not nipping in for chicken nuggets, was it all worth it?
I think it was worth it. I definitely think it was worth it. Like I say, it's only for a short while, and once you can't do this level of competition forever. So, like I say, you do it for a short while, you give it everything you've got, and then you can live the rest of your life. I mean, for me, this was my job. It's all I did 24/7.
We've got a lot of teachers here today. Of course, we've got some mums and dads who I think have snuck in. I think they're just big fans of you, to be fair, Linford. But I often say, behind any great athlete, behind any good human being, there's always people in the background, the unsung heroes, the mums and dads, the taxi drivers, as I call them as well. I'm one of those now. I read an article that your grandmother, Anita, was a big part in your kind of love of sport and love of running. Tell us a little bit about the role that she played in your upbringing.
Well, I grew up in Jamaica until the age of 7. And my parents went to the UK because my mum was a nurse. And at the time they wanted, sort of like what they call the Windrush generation. And I lived with my grandmother in Jamaica for the first 7 years of my life. And she was my role model. She was the kind of person I wanted to be like. And every time I tried to make a decision, she was the person that, I can go to and talk about it. And so I think, I was running around at the track for, my younger years. I mean, let me even go back further. Oh, I got started in athletics. I went to a school in London called Canberra Primary School in White City, which, well, some of us old enough, maybe I'm the only one old enough to know, they had the Empire Games or Commonwealth Games there. And so I went to a school there and I ran across the playground one day because I wanted to be like Georgie Best, who was a big footballer at the time. And I wanted to, I like most boys, I suppose, we want to be footballers. And I wanted to be Georgie Best. And I ran across the playground for football and my art teacher saw me running and he came out and he said, "You should try out for our school team because you're fast." And, I am 62 now and I really don't understand how he can just look out there and, at 7-year-old, 8-year-old and see the talent.
What was his name, your art teacher?
His name was Mr. Wright.
Mr. Wright's a hero.
Oh, Mr. Wright's a hero, trust me.
So we've got an Olympic gold, not because of you, Linford, sacrificing, it's because of Mr. Wright.
Oh, well, definitely. You see, and then, I was just messing around the track, doing bits and pieces, hanging out with my friends. And I went to English schools, which is a big competition. I was about 18 and I came second and never been coached or anything else. And everyone was kind of shocked. And then I got a coach. My teachers at school took me down to the local track. I got a coach and it's a guy called Ron Rodden. And he wrote me a letter, because I was messing around all the time. Then he wrote me a letter and said, "If you change your lifestyle, you could be really good." And I went home, discussed it with my grandmother. And she said to me, "You don't want to go through life saying, 'if only.'" She said, "If you give it a go, give it a try. If it doesn't work out, then at least you try. But if you don't, you're going to say, 'if only.'"
How old were you when he sent that letter?
I was about 25. So yeah, I spent a quarter of a century messing around.
less. And again, he was right, because you did make those sacrifices. And I do wonder, you know, whenever I've got a younger generation, you know, in front of me and we're doing talks like this, I always wonder about pieces of advice, because we're all seeking our own little piece of motivation. What motivates you, Linford, could be very different from what motivates me. But what is the bit of advice that you receive that still stays with you to this day?
I think it's enjoyment. I was told, if you love and enjoy what you do, the more you enjoy it, the harder you work. The harder you work, the better you'll get. And, you know, that is my mantra I take through life all the time.
Is it the same today? Because I'm going to sound like a right fuddy-duddy when I say this. An old man, essentially, is what I'm going to sound like. Social media. We know the advent of it. Is everyone on Instagram here? Yes, of course, nodding. Everyone is maybe a little too young to be on it yet, but social media has changed the world as we know it. That mantra there that you've said, is that still applicable today? Are these young kids, are they still kind of reacting to that type of advice?
I would think so, yes, because, you know, again, you have to teach the youth, and the most thing is that the more they enjoy something, they'll keep working at it. And if you give them something where the only thing is, it's got to be cool. And I think that's the word I use for youngsters, that everything has to be cool. And we were the sort of like the hard-edged generation. We went outside, we played outside 90% of the time on the streets and everything else. And, you know, for us, it was a little bit of training without knowing it. So it's a little bit more difficult now, because we didn't have social media, so we were outside, we didn't stay inside. I mean, when I was at school, computers were about 6 foot. We had binary cards and everything else to put in it. But now it's changed a lot, and we have to adapt to the situation. But, you know, it boils down to still enjoyment. Because if you can get the kids to enjoy something, then they'll stick to it.
They often say as well, boys and girls, it's a saying that's it's well told in elite sport and any life, again, I go back to any walk of life, that you learn more about yourself in failure than you do success. And I look at your career, Linford, and there was peaks and troughs. There's no doubt about that. You are you're a kind of walking poster boy for perseverance more than anything else. Talk to us a little bit about the low moments, because it's all good and well us sitting here talking about your highs. I want to know about the low moments. Talk to us about a couple of those and how you dealt with those.
Well, I mean, this is, you know, everyone sees the finishing product. And when I'm out with training, I mean, we're running in the snow. You get to the track in the winter, because you've got to train all through the winter, summer, you know, rain, sleet, snow, and you go out the track, and sometimes the track is covered in snow. And part of the warm-up, we would get a broom and everyone would sweep a lane just so we can train. And sometimes the training is so hard, you lay on the floor, you sleep in the snow. You know, my coach will give you 15 minutes recovery from a run, and you'll sleep for 10 of those in the snow, not knowing what to do. You pray a lot, you know, you say, dear God, please don't let me die here, because you feel that's what you got to go through, you know, we're a bit crazy. I think, you know, to be, you know, world-class athlete, you've got to be a bit touched in the head, I think, because you come back and you say, oh, I'll never do this again. And the next day you're back again, you never do this again. And the next day you're back, and this is how we do, because we have this memory where we can block things out and forget about it. So, yeah, I mean, it's, you know, I'm not going to sit here and say it's easy, it's hard. You get injuries. Injuries is, gosh, I've had so many injuries, you wouldn't believe it. You know, I pulled the muscle off the bone. And I mean, at the moment, strange thing, I walked across the car park there the other day and I stepped on a stone and pulled my calf.
That's old age, Linford.
I think that's exactly right. But, you know, so, I mean, that's what it is. But, you know, they've got to be lows. And this is where we get back to sacrifice. You know, and I say, if you look around and you're looking, everyone has to sacrifice something. You know, in order to be something, you have to go through something. And there's something, you know, if you've never had that experience, and experience maketh the man. So you have to have that experience. And if everything is hunky-dory all the time, then you're never going to stick to it. But when you've had those hard days and, you know, trials and tribulation, it makes you stronger. It's like breaking a bone. When you break a bone, it heals stronger. And this is how we've got to be.
It's all relative. Obviously, an Olympic Games is the pinnacle for these kids here this weekend. I'm sure there will be excitement. There'll be some nerves in there as well. I'll take you back to 1992, the night before the 100-meter final. Did you sleep Talk to us about where you were, how you got through it, the thoughts running through your head, and ultimately I'll take you all the way through to that start line. Mm. But the night before, how were your nerves?
I mean, it's very difficult to sleep when you're competing in, you know, in the big championships like this. You go to bed and you think you're asleep, you know, for 4, 5, 6 hours, and you get up and you only realize that you've only been sleeping for an hour. And wow. You lay there and your heart is just pumping away like crazy, you know, and it is very difficult. And sometimes, you know, if, you know, you don't want to take a sleeping tablet because then you'll feel too groggy in the morning. But we have to, you get up at maybe about 5 o'clock in the morning, then you go down, you got to get ready, have breakfast, and your appetite goes because you are so nervous. And you have to pretend that you're not nervous because you're walking through the dinner hall or wherever it is, and everyone else who you compete against is looking at you. And they can read you like a book. So you have to, you know, walk in and pretend you're not tired, and, you know, you sit there and all you can have, you know, well, for me, I piece of toast and maybe a cup of tea. That's all you're, you know, you just can't eat. And so you have to get, then you get to the track and you have to get your massage, you warm up and everything else, and then you have, you've got to plan it because you get to the call room maybe an hour before you need to go out on the track, and then they check your numbers, they check your shoes, they check everything to make sure it's all right. Then you get in the coach, you walk up, you know, you walk a bit, and then they check you again, and then they put you in a call room, and it's a room like this, and everyone you're competing against, you are sitting with them.
And are you staring at them? I mean, what are you doing? You know, you look slow today. You definitely look slow. What are you? Are you speaking to one another? What are you doing?
We don't speak at all because I think everyone's nervous. But you know, there's a lot of mind games going on in there. And I think what you've got to realize is the race is won before you get on the track, because you have to get into people's heads. You know, I say we all train. We train the physical, the body, and everything else. But not many people train the mind.
Yeah.
So you have to get into people's mind, because if we're all as talented as each other, we all train virtually the same way. So how are you going to beat the guy you run against? So you have to get into their minds. And so there's a lot of mind games going on in there.
I want you to be very honest here, Linford. The night before 1992, and again, we're going into the elite psychology of a sportsman, a legend. Lying in bed, did you ever think, what if I slip coming out of the box?
No.
What if I trip? What if I finish fourth? Was there any negative thoughts that got into your head that night before?
No, not at all. You cannot allow yourself to have negative thoughts at all. And for that period of time, the night before, the only thing you may do, you may run the race in your mind, because you have to run it how you think it's going to go. And it's always finishes with you being in the front. But you have to have confidence is the biggest thing in our sport, and you have to have ultimate confidence in your ability, and that you've done the right training, that you've got the right people behind you. And if you leave one room for doubt, then it's all over, because you can do the same training 1 year and get it all right, and you do the same the following year and it's all wrong. So it's, you've got to have a lot of faith in the training. If you believe the training you're doing is right, it will work. If you don't, it won't.
So we're a few minutes out from the start of the race. You're in the call room. Your competitors are there. The call comes over the tannoy. Can the 100-metre male runners make their way out? What's the stomach doing at this point? Are you running to the nearest bathroom? What are you doing, Linford?
I think you'll go to the toilet maybe 5-6 times in an hour period. You go and then you always feel like you need to go again. It's just nerves. You go and nothing happens, and you come back again, and it's just one of those things. But you know, so once they call you, you walk out in your lanes, and you go through a tunnel. And I always say that's the scariest thing in the world, because you walk in, you know, you're in the call room, and as soon as you get out through the tunnel, there's, you know, 60, 100,000 people, and everyone's cheering, and that is the dangerous
part. You hear it.
And you have to make yourself believe that they're only cheering for you. You know, even if they're cheering for someone else, the only thing that you can focus on is that the whole stadium is there to watch you run. And that's the mind game. So you're walking out, and if you're in lane four or five, I mean, I always walk in the front. So, you know, you start off and you walk out and then you run in. I mean, I run the race in my mind saying, okay, I'm going to overtake you. I'm going to go past you. And I go to work it out till I get to the front of the queue and I'm the first person out. And sometimes they'll send you back because you have to stick in your lane.
So you're already, in a lot of ways, on the walk to the starting blocks, you're already thinking, I'm going to get past you, I'm going to get past you.
Yeah.
That's brilliant, though. I find that fascinating. So you would want to be at the front because it's all about training the mind. I've got to be at the front because I'm going to be at the
exactly.
front.
Exactly. You don't want to be the guy at the back. You don't want to walk out the back at all. You have to, I mean, everything you focus on is with you.
I can just see tomorrow now, Linford, the kids are going to be sprinting to the front. No, you get out the way. It'll be carnage tomorrow, so teachers, be aware of that.
Yeah, I mean, that's what it is. You know, you have to, you know, the focus of everything is you. You have to, I mean, they say it's, you've got to be selfish. And I think it's a little bit that you've got to be a little bit of everything to, you know, to be that kind of runner.
I've always wondered, and put me in the picture on this one, Linford, if you're at the front and that couple of seconds, your name is read out, where does the mind go? Because I know I've been in places, I've done radio shows and I've hosted events where I'm thinking, did I leave the door unlocked? Did I leave my light on? Where does the mind go? Are you ever, again, you're focused, yes, but are you ever wandering off, there's someone I recognise in the crowd, or is it just laser focus on that finish line?
It's got to be laser focus. You just see yourself, and, you know, you can't be distracted at all. So you walk out, and then you get to, you know, you gain your lane and everything else, and it's still a focus. I mean, you'll do some runs, some jumps, and whatever it is that takes you there, you sit down, and at the same time, your heart is pumping away like crazy. And we're all afraid, but you've got to make the next guy believe that he's more afraid than you are. And that's what it is. So you have, you know, you see me sometimes, you know, I'm focused, my eyes are wide, and I'm just, all I can see is, you know, A to B. The finishing line is the only thing, so I've got to get from A to B as quick as possible. And the quicker you finish, the quicker you can go home.
You talk about embracing fear. That seems far easier said than done. How do you welcome fear in? How do you turn fear? Because we all have it, we're human beings. How do you turn fear into a positive thing?
Well, I mean, to be honest, I never look at fear as being negative, to be honest. You get the adrenaline, is what we call it, and the adrenaline is a protector, and it's telling you, it should protect your body because you're going to go and do something which is extraordinary. And so that's what it is. So you're nervous and everything else, and that's because, you know, you are getting ready to do something which you're hoping no one else can do. So everything has to be a positive. You have to embrace everything, and it's all channeled in, you know, it's like we need to be aggressive, but it's got to be channeled aggression. So, you've got to be aggressive inside, but still on the outside, you've got to be relaxed. And, you know, sometimes, you know, your face doesn't look like you're being relaxed, but we are, you know, totally relaxed. Because the guy who runs the fastest but stays relaxed the longest, that wins the race.
So here we go then. On your marks, you step forward into those blocks. Again, I narrow down. On your marks, get set. Where's the mind? Don't fall, don't fall, don't fall.
No, there's nothing in the mind at all. It's too late. By that time, if you're thinking anything, it's all over for you. You've got to clear your mind, you've got to empty your mind of everything else. And the only thing that may go in your mind is that as soon as the gun goes, you just got to get out of Dodge. You've got to get out as fast as you possibly can. And that's what it is. But you haven't got enough time to think. It's too late. There's nothing anyone can do that's going to help you. So the mind's got to be clear and the focus. You get there and you focus on the gun. So you have one ear on the gun and it's just there, and as soon as you hear a click, we always say the B of the bang, you've got to go in the B of the bang.
B of the bang. And you're up and running. You're out of, you've done well. You've got out the blocks, you've not tripped. You're now running. Now, you are famous for that stare that you talk about. I don't think you've blinked in about 20 years, Linford. Right, so you're not blinking. Are you still tunnel, or do you have your periphery? Or do you know who's slightly ahead of you? Can you see your competitors left and right?
You don't want to see. If you don't see anybody, that means you're in the lead. If you see people, you know, the problem is, like with a lot of people, is that as soon as you start running, someone comes on your shoulder, and automatically you then change, and then your shoulders will come up and you start to go tight, and then you start to fight. You have to concentrate, not see anybody, and just stay relaxed. And the reason for my stare was the year before in 91, went to World Championships and I finished fourth. And I felt I was in the lead, and all of a sudden, when the guys came on my shoulder, I just went tight. So I had to find a way that would help me. So if I see them, I would stay focused. And I thought about wearing blinkers like horses do and everything so you don't see anyone and anything else. And I realized one day in training that if I, you know, open my eyes really wide, then I can blur everyone else around out. And so, you know, I thought, ooh, that's, you know, something. So we tried it for a little while and everything, and we realized it worked. And so that's the reason why,
wow,
you know, I did that.
Wow. Right then, you crossed that finish line, 9.96, if memory serves me correct. That emotion, because there might be, listen, I'm going to say there's going to be a lot of Olympic champions in this room. The reality is only a very few get to Olympic gold. The euphoria, talk us about the emotions that you felt at that point.
It's at that point you realise your life has changed. You move off the back page onto front page, and then you realise that now you belong to the people. You know, your life no longer belongs to you. And I think that's what it is. But, you know, up until then, also you think about all the hard times you had in training and everything else. You know, you do it, you know, for your coach, your training partners, because, again, we talk about the people behind. You know, my coach, who's out there with me, rain, sleet, snow. You know, and it's harder for him because he's standing up and I'm moving, so I'm a lot warmer than he is. And then, you know, all the people that sacrificed, you know, their time and, you know, sponsors, everyone else that helps, supports you, then you realise, you know, for them, this is, you know, this is for them. And, you know, you train, you know, 4 years. 4 years for 9 seconds. You know, that's kind of surreal when you think about it. You train 4 years. I mean, some people, they give up after 4 weeks. But you have to persevere. You have to do the same thing day in, day out, 4 years, just to run 9 seconds.
Can I ask a very personal question here, Linford? Did you shed a tear? Did you have a quiet moment where you let it all out, you know, from your gran, the sacrifices mum and dad made? Did it all just come pouring out?
No, I didn't cry at all. And, there's two reasons behind that. The first thing is that if you cry, that's the picture that they will always show. That's going to embarrass you for the rest of your life. You know, but, and the second reason, that, you know, for me, I think, is what it's sometimes it could be seen as weakness. And you cannot show weakness on the track. You have to, you know, stay strong all the time. Even when you're tired, sometimes you have to, you know, you walk around the corner and you catch your breath, and then as soon as someone comes, you stand up and you walk, and you've got to make everything look easy because your opponents can read you. Mm. And if they realize, even like during the rounds, that you're tired, then that will give them that little bit more confidence, you know, to beat you. So you have to, the idea is, you know, whether it's good or bad, is try and keep your opponents down and keep yourself on top.
How did you deal with self-doubt, Linford, because we've all got it. Again, I go back to, we're all human beings. We wouldn't be human if at times we don't have insecurities, if we don't have times where we doubt whether we can actually do something. You know, I've spoken at length on my radio show about imposter syndrome. At times you think, how the heck have I made it here? You know, we deal with these human emotions. For you, how did you deal with those insecurities and that self-doubt?
Well, I mean, the first thing is that I've never been in a race which I never thought I could win. And you know, they do say all men are created equal, but I believe in some more equal than others. And the only time I've ever got close enough to doubting myself was at the World Championships in 93. And my main rival was a guy called Andre Kaysen. And, you know, whatever I did in one round, he would go faster. And I was on the track getting ready, you know, because I'd already done my semi-final. And I'm getting ready for the final, and he was racing, and it came over that he ran 9.92, which at the time was, I think, my personal best. And it came over the tan line, and I thought, oh, God. And I looked at my coach, and I said, did you hear that? And he said, he goes, what the hell are you worried about? He goes, you've done it. He's got to go over, and he's got to get there and do it again.
Yeah.
And with him just saying that, that just gave me the confidence that you know, I didn't have anything to worry about. But that's the only time I came close to doubting. You know, we'll say, I mean, I didn't, you know, some guys, they have a lucky shoe, lucky something, you know. I had none of those.
No superstitions?
No superstitions at all. Because if you got a lucky shoe and one day you forget it, then what's going to happen?
Yeah.
So you have nothing at all. You clear. I mean, I take off all my jewelry, everything, and it's just me.
So you weren't like Michael Johnson with that big gold necklace.
No, just me and my prayers. That's all it is. I mean, everybody prays, you know. And sometimes I always try to say to people, it's a little bit more than just going out there and running. It's a bit spiritual. I honestly believe. I think you get energy from people. That's why, you know, they say home crowd advantage.
Yeah.
So you get that little bit of extra energy from the supporters and everything else, and people out there willing you on to win.
Got to ask about 1996, if I can. And again, boys and girls, ladies and gentlemen, an opportunity to ask Linford your own questions. Give me another couple of minutes and we'll do just that. I promise you, an opportunity to do that. 1996, Linford, compare and contrast emotions. Olympic gold in 92, for the kids that aren't aware, I hate to do this to you, but it's important. It builds minerals, this. Of course, you double faulted. You had to walk away from an Olympic final. Take us back there, because again, it's all about character building.
Well, I'll admit the first one. The second one definitely wasn't. And, you know, the problem is, like, you know, with a false start, it's not scientific.
No.
And so if you train, you know, you train every aspect of your race, and of course, I mean, you see people doing blocks all the time. Of course, you're going to get faster. But they say, for me, they said I reacted too soon after the gun, which again is kind of crazy, because if the gun's gone, then,
yeah,
you know, but it was life. It's just one of those things. And, you know, I was, I suppose, you know, say I was upset is an understatement, but, you know, I didn't cry. You just walk off, and it's part and parcel of what it is. You know, it's the emotion that takes over, because, you know, you've trained, you know, all, you know, for this moment. But at the same time, I mean, I was 36 years old, and, you know, well, could I have got a medal? Yes. Winning was, you know, I mean, Donovan Bailey won, he broke the world record, so, yeah. You know, that was an amazing, you know, performance in itself. So I was defending champion, so, you know, I'd rather have gone out, you know, in the race, but I think it would have been a, you know, second or third would have been the most I could have expected. So, you know, it's just one of those things. And if I'd never been Olympic champion before, then maybe it would have hurt a lot. But it's life.
I was thinking last night, I'm speaking to Linford tomorrow. What's a question? It kind of dawned on me. You've already said it, so don't get mad at me for saying this. You're 62 now. Look at the nick of this guy for 62. You look magnificent, Linford. Do you still run 100 metres?
I don't run at all.
You don't?
I don't run at all. I don't even jog. I don't do anything. I mean, when I first retired, I thought I can, you know, go out there and, I mean, there's a difference between, I suppose, a jogger and a runner. And I thought I could become, you know, a jogger and I can do 5Ks. So I was doing, you know, a couple of 5Ks, and you're doing that on the roads, and you get to a point when the cars will go past and they will see me. The guys go on then, I'm trying to look. You know, and then they go past, I'm going, you know, asthma takes over. So I just think that my body is not built, you know, for jogging. You know, I mean, now I weigh 105 kilos now. I mean, when I was competing, I was between 80 and 85 kilos. So, you know, we're just not built for that. And it's not something I enjoy.
So what you're saying is, if I took you out to the car park, I'd beat you over 100 metres.
Ah, definitely.
You know. I love that. Right, we're going to go and do that. I need to get that on my CV.
You know, the worst thing is, sorry to cut you, but I was walking across the car park. I was telling a couple of guys, I stepped on a stone a couple of days ago, and I pulled my calf. I'm walking now, and every time I try to walk and try to hide it, you know, I can still feel it. So, yeah, I mean, I do a little bit of gym. I go in the gym, and I lift weights with the guys, but running is not for me anymore.
What about that Olympic gold medal? I'm always fascinated by this. I've been very fortunate. I've spoken to a number of Olympic medalists in my career. Some say they have it by their bedside table. Some say, no, safely in a deposit box. I go and watch it, or I look at it once a year. Where is your Olympic gold medal?
I think mine is in a box somewhere, maybe in the attic or something like that. You know, it's, you know, I've got to tell you, it's not real gold.
It's not.
No, it's not real gold at all.
I didn't think I knew that.
The silver medal is worth more than the gold medal, believe it or not. It's only a sentimental value. The silver is real silver. The gold is just, You know, they someone got in
the way
and sprayed it.
They're clearly the IOC Scottish, if that's the case, Linford.
Yeah, so yeah, I mean, I think, you know, if you come to my house, I try not to have any sort of like memorabilia or anything else, because I don't want my kids, you know, none of my kids run. I got a son who's 19 now, and he's fast, but he's just not interested in athletics whatsoever. And I think it's because he'll always be compared with me. And so, you know, and I don't want that for my kids. So, you know, I don't force them to do sports. They all do some form of, you know, sport. But now there's nothing in my house that will tell you that, you know, I was an athlete or anything else like that, because it's history.
I think I know the answer to this, but are you ever sat on your sofa one night watching TV thinking to yourself, I'm going to go up to the attic, got to dust those medals out and have a little look? Did you ever do that?
No, not at all. You know, one day I got my kids down and I sat there and I said, you need to watch some of my races to see where your bike comes from. And we, after we were watching a couple, of my daughter would say, Dad, can we fast forward it now? So, yeah, I mean, you know, it's just one of those things, like, you know, for me, I think, you know, I did it, and it's great to have the memory, but again, I just don't want to leave him in the hype.
Last one from me, and I promise, Linford, because I said to you half an hour, it's been an hour. Last one from me, it's the best thing about being Linford Christie.
Gosh, I can walk in the shop and get things free. No, I mean, to be honest, I don't know what is. I think, you know, is, I suppose being me, you know, I love being me, you know, and you've got to, you know, there's rough and smooth. You've got to take the rough with the smooth, but no, I wouldn't, you know, I wouldn't swap being me for anything else. But yeah, I mean, I do walk in the shop and get things free, so that's about it.
I wish I got things for free. Linford, boys and girls, ladies and gentlemen, it's been an hour. I have to thank you for your patience. The questions, by the way, were excellent. Not from me, from you guys out there. I've
Absolutely.
Got, I think, a bit of competition. One more time, give her up for this man.
Thank you.